is a glass coffin. It's actually, it is an MRI CT angle. It has got a lot of coffin inside it. So I will take majority of my time with this coffin. And I will focus a little bit of time on the X-ray of mascot, this is my other coffin. So coming into what is the CT angle, where is the exact location? You see, it's actually a inverted drag, the subarachnoid space. It's actually located on the posterior fossa in the brain. Okay, it contains the 5th to 11th medial nerves, the CSF, the dura, and also the radicular and vessel arteries. So before I go to the CT angle of and this is an analysis structure. Let me just show you what the basic sequence is in MRI. So let's come to the basic sequence in MRI. This is the classical T2-weighted image. So how exactly do you tell this is a T2-weighted image? You look at the CSF. Basically, any area with CSF will be bright on T2. So if you see the ventricles, these are the lateral ventricles, you see that the CSF is bright. So this is actually a T2-weighted image. One more thing to notice is if you look at the white pattern, that is at all this corona radiata and the internal capsule, these are all dark on T2. It is because the myelin that you see, that is the, that contains lipid. So the lipid is generally dark on T2. So that is why the two things which differentiate a T2 red sequence, one is the CSF will be bright and the white pattern which contains myelin will be dark. So that's how you differentiate a T2 and a T1. So now next. Once I told you about T2, let's go to T1 weighted image. So you see a T1 weighted image. You see that the CSF is dark. So any fluid per se will be dark on a T1 weighted image. So CSF, when you see in the lateral ventricles, will be dark. So, and one more thing which I told earlier, the white matter that you see in a T1 weighted image will be bright. So that is how you can differentiate it from a T2 image. One is the CSF, the other one is white matter. So if you see the white matter as bright and the CSF to be dark, you will possibly make out that it is a T1 weighted image. The next sequence is a flare. Now what is a flare? It's actually fluid attenuated inversion recovery. What you exactly do, you take a T2 image and you suppress the CSF out of it. So basically when you see, you see that the ventricles are dark because you have suppressed the images from the CSF. So you have CSF which is dark, but you can see that the white matter is dark, similar to T2. In T2 we had the CSF bright and the white matter dark. In flare, because we are suppressing the white matter, because we are suppressing the CSF from the T2, we will find the ventricles would be dark, but the characteristic treatment of the myelin will be preserved, so it will be dark. So that is how you differentiate. Now, how do you differentiate this flare sequence from T1? Because in both you have ventricles to be dark. So you see the white matter, that is where the white matter comes into the picture. The white matter in T1 will be bright, whereas in flare it will be dark. So that is how you differentiate. So these are the conventional signals that we use routinely. That is why I am focusing on this. Then last but not the least, the diffusion weighted image. Very useful for a CP angle lesion. What does diffusion do? A diffusion weighted image actually picks up areas which have restricted Brownian motion. This constantly in the neuroparenchyma you have the molecules moving here and there. If in any area the molecules are being restricted, and their movement is restricted, then the diffusion and the MRI will pick up that area as a bright signal. So commonly in an area of an infarct or in an area of an epidermoid, you will find that it will be bright on diffusion image because that area, the movement of the water molecules is restricted. So these are the four basic sequences which everybody needs to know. Let's come back to the main topic. So the anatomy of CP angle is superiorly is the tympanum, inferiorly is the scapula, transient medullary orbit, anteriorly is the posterior surface of the vitreous bone, posterior is the mantle surface of pons and cerebellum. So, can anybody tell what is the sequence? The CSF is bright here, so it's a T2 weighted sequence. Okay, so it's a T2 weighted sequence. What is exactly seeing here? This is the pons. This is the fourth ventricle. This is the vomis. This is the cerebellar hemisphere. These are the two cranial nerves, the 7th and the 8th cranial nerves. This is the internal acoustic canal from where the two nerves are going. And this is the basilar artery. So whenever you try to take an image from the human body, we need a static proton nuclei. Suppose in any area we don't find the proton nuclei as stagnant or they are moving, then we will not get any signal from that area. So that area will be showing as a flow void or a dark space. So all the vessels in the brain will be showing a T2 dark area because there will not be any signal from that area. Similarly from the bone, we will not get enough protons to pick up the signal. So it will be a T2 dark. This is the captured image. You have the pons, the middle cerebellar peduncle, this is the fourth ventricle, and this is the CP angle which we are keenly interested about. One thing to know is this is a small anatomical structure which commonly protrudes into the CP angle. This is actually the trochlus of the cerebellum. It's a normal anatomical structure and you should not mistake it to be any lesion. So this is actually, as I am told earlier, this is one of the good slides which I had. Which actually I picked from the internet, but anyway, this is the 7th nerve anteriorly and the popliteal division of the 8th nerve post anterior inferiorly and the superior and inferior vestibular divisions posteriorly. So, coming to CP angle lesions per se, most of the lesions are on this tree: acoustic schwannoma, meningioma, epidermoid. Rest of the lesions are come to a very minuscule percentage. So most of the time I will be focusing on these three regions. Secondary tumors of the surrounding regions can also come into the CP angle. This includes paraganglioma or also known as the stromal tumors, cheminoma, gonadoma and chordomas. And uncommon CP angle masses are arachnoides, lipomas, dermoides. I will be telling briefly about all this. CT MR both are used and most of the time we have to deal with only these first three pathologies. This is acoustic schwannoma, meningioma, and epidermoid. So we basically dealing with these. In adults, the extra-axial lesions are more common. When I say extra-axial, it means that the majority of the lesions are arising from the structures from the system. If the structures in the brain parenchyma give rise to the lesion, it is called intra-axial lesion. Whereas if it is from the cisternal lesions, or any lesion outside the brain parenchyma per se, then we call it as extra-axial. So in younger children, the intra-axial lesions like gliomas are more common, whereas in adults, the extra-axial lesions like acoustic schwannomas, meningioma, and epidermoids are more common. So before coming to pathology, the four normal things which we should actively look for and try to avoid mistaking it for a tumor. One is the asymmetrical jugular tubercle. This is a CT image. Always you can make out the CT image from an MR image because CT image generally has the bone as bright. Okay, I am almost reducing the listing. The CT, you can have, the bone has to be hyperdense in radiological terms, but if you have to call it in other terms, you can call it bright. So if the bone is bright, then you are dealing with a CT image. Generally when you see a scan per se, whether we have taken a CT or an MRI, generally for for the bone, it's usually hyperdense or CT or bright as it says. So in this case, an asymmetrical jugular tubercle, so which is mimicking as a lesion in the CT angle. Other one would be an enhancing choroid plexus. So it's a normal choroid plexus which will go to the foramina brusca into the cistern and which will enhance normally. So these are the structures which can be commonly doing as a pathology. Other one is the cerebellar scapulus here. But the closest thing which you can see here, this is actually a lesion sitting here. So this is how the lesion will be in a meningioma, and you can see that softer is the normal variant which is seen separately. Should one actively look for it. So now whenever we get a lesion in the kidney angle, first thing to differentiate is it is an extraaxial lesion or an intraaxial lesion. So what are the signs to say it's an extraaxial lesion? You look at the CP cistern per se. If the cerebelloangle cistern is enlarged, then you will think it is an extraaxial lesion. Second, because the lesion is arising from the CP angle per se, the CSF will be there all around the margins of the lesion. So if you have any lesion which the CSF is surrounding all of its borders, then you are pretty sure it's an extraaxial lesion. Then there will be displacement of gray white matter interface. The brainstem will be rotated and the fourth ventricle will be compressed. So this is a gross anatomy specimen of a CP angle tumor. You can see that there is a good number of space around the tumor. So if you have an active CSF space surrounding the entire lesion, you will know that it's an extraaxial lesion. Now what is the other thing? This is a CSF cleft in between the lesion and the brainstem. So you can know that this is actually a cleft in between and these two, this is an extraaxial lesion. Third thing is, whenever the cistern is enlarged and the tumor is enlarging, it will buckle the underlying brain parenchyma. So there you are sure that it is an extraaxial lesion. Suppose it was an intraaxial lesion, there will be widening of this particular structure. Okay, the middle cerebellar parenchyma would have widened and would have been bulky. So that is not happening here. So it's actually a buckling of the gray white matter junction here. And fourth ventricle is compressed. It's a non-specific finding. It can be seen in both. So coming to the most common of these acoustic schwannomas, basically arising from the vestibular component. The acoustic neuroma is a misnomer because it arises from the vestibular component and as well as it is actually a schwannoma. It's a benign slow-growing encapsulated tumor and accounts for 60-90% of the CPA tumors. There is a female predominance. Clinical features, I'm sure you will be doing much better than me. Meniscus, sensorineural, hearing loss, decreased speech discrimination, and very late stage, depending upon the nerve involved, it will be vestibular dysfunction, facial nerve involvement, facial paresthesia, or trigeminal nerve involvement. Cloacal nerves are involved, the cerebellar signs can be seen, and hydrocephalus can be seen. The grading is based upon small, medium, large, and giant tumors. Usually the intracanalicular tumors are less than 0.5 cm. Medium will be 0.5 to 2, large will be 2 to 4, and giant will be more than 4. CT per se for acoustic schwannoma is a poor investigation if you are doing for a plain CT scan. Because any lesion of a posterior fossa in a CT scan will have a lot of artifacts from the surrounding bone. Because of the beam hardening artifacts, will have a lot of streaky artifacts in the posterior fossa of the CT scan. So you tend to miss most of this acoustic schwannoma in a plain scan. Whereas if you give a contrast, then the lesion will pick up nicely on a CT scan. Also in MR, you will have hypointensity on T1, hyperintensity on T2. Basically T2 is for any pathology, we look for T2 image. If you want to look for anatomy, you look for T1 image. So any pathological lesion having lot of fluid and lot of similarity will become T2 iso to hyperintensity. So any tumors, generally tumors per se are bright on T2. So the general features of the acoustic schwannoma, if you look at it, this is actually a characteristic location of acoustic schwannoma. Now how do you differentiate it from various other causes? You look at the angle it forms with the pitless temporal bone. You look at the angle here. The angle which the mass is forming with the pitless temporal bone is an acute angle. This will not be so in case of a meningioma. The meningioma, the mass will form an obtuse angle of the pitless temporal bone because it arises from the dura of the pitless temporal bone. Another thing is, it commonly extends into the internal acoustic canal. A schwannoma is much more commonly associated with intracanalicular extension than a meningioma. Then, once it extends into the internal aortic canal, it starts to widen the internal part aortic canal. you can see the extension into the inner artery canal and the tumor forming an acute angle here. It generally shows a homogeneous attachment, and one thing to notice, there is not any dural tail. Dural tail occurs when there is actually a localized reaction to the surrounding tumor, and it is more common or more extensively seen in case of a meningioma. Schwannoma will not cause that much of a reaction from the surrounding dura, though it may occur. But generally, if we see a dural tail, we call it as a meningioma. Generally, and there are usually no classifications. There are different types like Antony A and Antony B, which you see in pathology. But generally, Antony A, because of its high cellularity, will become D2 high soil intense and much more of a solid component in the tumor. And Antony B, because of the loosely interspersed mixoid tissue, is more of a cystic variation in a schwannoma. This is a classical ice cream cone appearance of the acoustic schwannoma with infracanalicular extension. Now, as I told earlier, this is a CT scan image. You can see that the bone is dense, and you see a lot of artifacts, the sticky artifacts that you are seeing there. This is actually a plain scan. And if you know that, you see the contrast image, there is a huge tumor sitting in a CT angle, okay? And when the plain scan, you are not able to make out because it's actually isodense to the cerebellum. And also because of this artifacts, you are not able to clearly make out. So a lot of the time when you are actually ordering for a plain CT scan to rule out a CP angle region, you tend to miss it because it's actually isodense. But yes, if you give contrast, it will show good amount of enhancement, and you can also see this acute angle. MRI is basically going to see the displacement of vitrocerebral capsule or veins, and it will actually show the hemorrhage in various stages. Actually, the contrast enhanced MRI with gadolinium will show intense enhancement. Also, as you know, acoustic schwannomas are bilaterally associated with NF type 2, and also other tumors are the meningiomas and the ependymomas. And NF type 1 also you have in 5% of the cases acoustic neuromas, but more commonly if you have bilateral vestibular schwannomas, you tend to call as acoustic, you will call as NF type 2. So this is a classical case of NF type 2. Notice there are many acoustic schwannomas and non-acoustic schwannomas. You are seeing an acoustic schwannoma extending into the intracranial canal. You are seeing a trigeminal schwannoma, which is actually the mental scale enhancement. This is actually a different post contrast image. We are actually seeing one more region, is actually a meningioma. We are actually seeing a dural tail here. Okay, so this is actually a meningioma, multiple acoustic and non-acoustic schwannomas. And this is actually a facial nerve schwannoma also associated with it. So this is the case of classical NF type 2. And secondary changes, as I said earlier, whenever the tumor extends into the inner artery canal, you will have it as widening on the inner artery canal. So in this large lesion here sitting in the right CP angle, if you take the bone window, you see that the internal artery canal on the right side as compared to the left side is grossly widened. The same thing if you see in a case of meningioma, you will have some kind of hyperostosis. You will see that there are areas of calcification in this internal artery canal which is not seen here per se. Only the internal artery canal is widened here, which is seen in a classical case of acoustic schwannoma. So other changes can be seen with a large lesion like connection into the medullary fossa or hydrocephalus. The next tumor is coming, it's commonly meningioma. It arises from the meningocele arachnoid cells, and the thing to differentiate from schwannoma is it is broad based against the dual surface and hemispherical in gross specimen, and forms an obtuse bone tumor angle. So if you see a pictorial radiograph, you can see that this is a schwannoma, is forming an acute angle, and this is a meningioma with a broad base to the dura and a obtuse angle with underlying tumorous bone. So this is a classical case of meningioma. You can see that it's a broad base to the dura with a dural tail, and you can see here. This dural tail can be due to a reaction by the meningioma, or it could be due to infiltration. But this dural tail is not very specific. Say the specificity varies from 50 to 80%, and in on other lesions can also present with this dural tail, like metastasis, like malignant melanoma. All of these can produce a dural tail. But generally, radiologists, whenever we see dural tail, we tend to call it as a meningioma. It can extend into inner artery canal, but the classical teaching is it will not widen the inner artery canal as much as the acoustic schwannoma. So basically, the one as I told you, in acoustic schwannoma, it was isodense to the cerebellum. The meningioma will be hyperdense. So if you actually, when you look at CT scan, you will pick it up as a hyperdense structure, and calcification is there will be homogeneous enhancement in the post contrast scan, and there will be some amount of hyperostosis. So if you see CT scans or plain scans, as compared to the acoustic schwannoma, you can actually make out the, in the plain scan that there is a lesion in the CP angle, and it will show post contrast enhancement. And if you see close in the bone window, you can see some amount of ossification or calcification in the interauditory canal. This is actually the hyperostosis by a meningioma extending into the interauditory canal. You can see that the interauditory canal bilaterally are of almost similar size, only except for the hyperostosis. Now, this is another calcified lesion is extending into the interauditory canal. So MRI is either ratio intense. The characteristic of an meningioma is when the intensity of the tumor is less than or equal to gray matter, then meningioma is usually the diagnosis. And the durability they have seen around 50 to 72%, they represent actually the reactive than neoplastic changes. So in MRI, if you want to see, check for the hyperostosis, you will see that it is dark. As I told you earlier, MRI the bone will be dark because of loss of the number of protons which are giving rise to the signal. So you can see that the hyperostosis will actually be dark on an MRI. This is the post contrast image, you can see good enhancement. This is another densely calcified meningioma, because the calcification also be dark on MRI. If you look at, you are looking at the meningioma as well as the vitreous bone being dark. So the actually the intensity of the meningioma depends upon the constituents of the meningioma per se, and when it when there are fibrous elements in that, it becomes hypointense to gray matter. And MRI per se can define the marginal pyoid vessels as well as the CSF space and cleft and arterial feeders. So the other disease for dural thinning can be oligodendroglioma, the schwannoma, glioblastoma, and metastasis. So you can see in a case of a classical case of a rectomeningeal metastasis from a prostate SCA, you can see diffuse dural thickening in both internal and acoustic canal. So generally a dural tail and thinking of a dural tail does not mean it's a meningioma. It can also be rectomeningeal metastasis. And other disease for meningioma for a dural tail could be a primary meningeal lymphoma, melanoma, sarcoid, Lyme, TB, anything. So we just need to remember that there are a lot of lesions which become in CP angle. This is the case of malignant melanoma presenting as CP angle lesion with extension into the internal acoustic canal. And another idiopathic hypertrophic pachymeningitis with dural thickening, and which is showing post contrast enhancement. So other the third most common region of CP angle region is an epidermoid. These are nothing but congenital intradural ectodermal cell rest, and they consist of stratified squamous epithelial lining surrounding the disordered keratin, and they tend to insinuate into the surrounding structures. So by the time the patient reaches you, the tumor or the lesion will be of a large size, and generally that is why it is not present clinically in young patient or in children, and it takes around roughly 10 to 20 years for it to present, because it tends to insinuate into the surrounding structures, and usually have cauliflower like irregularity. The classical epidermoid on a CT scan will be hypodense, and on an MRI will be T1 hypointense and T2 hyperintense, and with no enhancement. That's how we differentiate it from a acoustic schwannoma and a meningioma, because both of them will show enhancement, whereas an epidermoid will generally not show any kind of enhancement. In CT scan also, on post contrast scan, there will not be any enhancement in the epidermoid. So this is a classical CT image of a very hypodense region you are seeing in the CP angle with no obvious post contrast enhancement. And MRI, when you try to do this FISP image, where you are trying to find out whether there are any fine capsule or tissue strands seen within it. So this will tend to improve the diagnostic quality. So in an MRI, you see that T1-rated images, the lesion is hypointense, and on post contrast, no significant enhancement is seen. This is a classical image of the epidermoid. The one thing, one sequence in which differentiates an epidermoid from rest of the lesions are the diffusion-rated imaging. As I told you earlier, epiderma will show a diffusion restriction. That in the diffusion rate image, the lesion becomes bright. So if you have a differentiate from epidermoid, arachnoid, or a meningioma, you can look at epidermoid in the diffusion rate imaging. The diffusion rate imaging can show bright very bright image and diffusion-rated image. And also in post contrast scan, there will not be any enhancement. That's how we differentiate. The arachnoid cyst will have a similar appearance as an epidermoid cyst, but the classical sequence of diffusion, it will not be bright in arachnoid cyst. Okay, and there will not be any enhancement. Now there is a variation of an epidermoid called white epidermoid. So why is it a variant? Because of the high protein content, it will be bright on CT. A classical epidermoid will be hypotense on CT, whereas a white epidermoid will be bright on CT and also on T1. So whenever in any there are five pathologies or five structures which are bright on T1 variant, those are the hemorrhage, fat, melanin, sometimes the calcium, okay, and you can sometimes have fat and lipids will be bright on T1. So whenever you have bright things on T1, these are the four or five things which you have to remember. And high protein. So whenever you have high protein, that also becomes hypertension on T1. So how to differentiate white epidermoid from the rest of the things? You see that on the CT scan, which I showed you earlier, the epidermoid was dark or hypotense. But in this case, there is it's a bright lesion, and on a T1-rated images, it's bright. So basically, it's a bright on CT and as well as T1-rated images. You can either go back to differentiate it from the MRI, to differentiate it from a lipoma, which is also bright on T1. You will try to do a fat suppression sequence in the MRI. So if you give fat suppression in MRI, the lipoma will get suppressed, whereas the epidermoid will not get suppressed. So that is how you differentiate. Otherwise, go back and see the CT scan. In the CT scan, the fat will be hypotense, whereas the white epidermoid will be bright. I will show you the images subsequently. This is another case of white epidermoid, bright on T1, hypotense on T2. So this is the case of lipoma, as I told you earlier. See, on T1 rated images, it's bright. It is similar to white epidermoid. On D2 also it's almost bright and to iso intense. And you see, if I employ a fat suppression sequence, you see that the lesion has lost its signal. So this loss of signal characterizes this, that it is getting suppressed in fat, suppressed by fat. So it is actually a lipoma. So this is how we differentiate a white epidermoid from a lipoma. So this is how a lipoma will look like in a CT scan. A lipoma will be hypotense. Compare that with a white epidermoid. See, the white epidermoid will be bright on CT. The lipoma will be dark on CT because fat is hypotense. So the main features of an epidermoid is it's a low density cyst with lobulated margin. It insinuates into the surrounding structure. It might exert mass effect, but and the characteristic sequence is a diffusion imaging. So the main differential diagnosis I have already mentioned earlier. These are the three different common things we look. This is a post contrast image in all the three. You will see that acute angle in the acoustic dystronoma, an obtuse angle in the meningioma, and absolutely no enhancement in epidermoid or an arachnoid cyst. Okay, now coming to arachnoid cyst, they are similar density according to the CSF density. But they are actually because of the congenital arachnoid layer splitting and the CSF getting affected in between the layer. So you have arachnoid cyst have a CSF attenuation. So in all the sequence in MRI and all the CT, they closely mimic the CSF lesion. So arachnoid cyst will be actually as a normal CSF only on a CT scan and an MRI, and you have to look for surrounding structural differences and surrounding mass effect to differentiate it from the rest of the lesion. So this is same as an epidermoid, an arachnoid cyst will be hypointense on T1 and hyperintense on T2. It is almost CSF density. And post contrast, there will not be any significant enhancement. The main sequence is this diffusion rate imaging. The diffusion rate imaging is characteristically showing no restriction in arachnoid cyst. Because the same lesion, if it was an epidermoid, it would have been bright. Whereas arachnoid cyst, because in the diffusion rate imaging, there will not be any restriction of water flow or CSF flow. There will not be any restricted diffusion. Now, the other lesion can occur in CT angular cystic sarcosis. These are quite common. And the racemos variety where you can have plenty of cystic sarcosis can be seen in the CP angle. They will be similar to arachnoid cyst, but there will be some peripheral enhancement. And you can see the septa in between. the scolex may or may not be seen. So you cannot see any eccentric nodular enhancement in a ventricular or a racemos type of cisternal cysticercosis. But in the same case, in case of a cysticercosis in a neuroparenchyma, you will find a characteristic eccentric enhancement in neurocysticercosis if it was occurring in the parenchyma. But if it is in the ventricular system or cisternal system, you will not find that eccentric dot-like enhancement, which is actually the scolex. Other neurotic systems in a parenchyma are very rare entities, so I am not telling about those. Lipoma and dermoid have already told earlier will be hypertension CT and will be bright on T1. This actually I have told you earlier, so hypertension on the CT scan image. So actually that lipoma and it's bright on T1. And if undergo fat suppression, if you try to do a fat suppression. Then if you have non-acoustic post-report schwannoma arising from trigeminal ganglion, or it can have from the facial nerves, or it can have from 9, 10 lateral nerves. And most commonly it will be a trigeminal schwannoma after that. It will be a dumbbell type of tumor. You can see the dumbbell extension from the CP angle into the Meckel scale. So this kind of dumbbell tumor is quite classical for a trigeminal schwannoma. And it will have the characteristic of symptoms of an acoustic schwannoma. Facial nerve schwannomas,